I'm glad I did.
Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to Faith United Methodist Church. Please stand and join us as we continue our worship service this morning.
1, 2.
Pray, shall we? Gracious Heavenly Father, we welcome you into our service this morning with open arms, and we are so very thankful that we can continue to rest in you in whatever need we have. Lord, continue to be with us through this week. Open our ears and our hearts and our minds to hear your message today. For it's in all these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I look pretty silly up here by myself. Come on, gang. I got my two boys who almost beat me up here. Come on down. Hey, Paul. All right, bring your cars, big guy. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We are in a new month and a new season. First of all, what month are we in?
March.
That's exactly right. And the best part of March means spring is around the corner. But we got a lot of work before we get there. We are also in the season of Lent, which are the 6 weeks that lead up to Easter. And it's a time for us to really look at ourselves, look into our hearts, to do some intentional work, to learn what Jesus wants us to learn. So we have a great story from Jesus today. It's about a man who owed another man some money. It's the king who owned, had some money, and he lent it to a servant. And it was a lot of money. It was 100,000, actually it says 10,000 bags of gold. But I got a pretend $100,000 bill. That's a lot of money, right?
Yeah.
Thank you. And the servant came to the king and said, I can't repay the money right now. And what do you think the king did? Any ideas? Did the king get mad? Oh, you think, did he throw him in jail?
No.
Actually, he didn't get mad. Because the servant asked for forgiveness, and this king was a loving man, a kind man, and he said, yes, I will forgive you the debt. $100,000. Well, this is where the story gets interesting, because that same man who owed the king $100,000 was owed only $1,000. I got 10,000 by another man. Now, this guy was just forgiven by the king. What do you think he did to the person who owed him money? He didn't. I know. You would think he would. In fact, he throws him in jail. He didn't learn a thing, did he? And that's a way to show us that the king represents, of course, God. When we come to God and say, I'm sorry, God, I messed up. Will you forgive me? And God is going to say yes. He's going to want you to do things differently the next time. So he's going to want you to go live your life differently, unlike the servant who was forgiven. So it's tough stuff. See, this is hard, hard work. But it is great work, because there are going to be times in life when you're going to have to forgive people. So the bottom line says, forgive others because God forgives you. So the next time somebody does something wrong to you, I hope that you'll think long and hard about whether they deserve your forgiveness, because God forgives you and God loves you, and it's an important lesson. So you're going to have fun learning all about this in Sunday school, so let's say a prayer and get you to class, all right? Dear God, thank you for your forgiveness, and especially your love. Help us to forgive and love others. Amen. All right, have a great time in Sunday school, you guys. Good job, bud. Well, happy Lent to all of you. We start, oh boy, there we go. Get your car, bud. Right to Dad. 1, 2, 3. Yay! You did good, Paul. Lent is hard. There you go. That models it for you. But it's a season of tremendous opportunity and tremendous growth. And we hope you'll find a way to be engaged in some kind of practice, be it here in one of our groups or with others outside of this faith community, or even individually or with your family. Of course, we believe the more you do that together in community, the more successful you're going to be. So it's not too late to engage in our Lenten studies. Ellen's group missed this week because of the weather, so I know she's accepting people. We start this Wednesday with the We Are Beloved study that's coming up. All that information is in your newsletter. We're just going to poke and prod and encourage you to give us these 6 weeks. Not us, actually. Give God these 6 weeks as we learn about our own faith. And then we especially would like those of you who are dealing with the loss of a loved one to know about our grief share group, which will be starting March 10th. And the Arnolds who are here will be leading that, and we are very excited about that. So if you or somebody that you know is dealing with the loss of a loved one, we encourage you to engage in that. And then we just want to say thanks. Every week, Gene Huddleston thought we were done with stuff for the canteen run, and he brought more in and more in. We must have a dozen emails of updates. But the grand total is 1,418 items. And Gene could not be more excited. So thank you for your support of that. Lots of great things. My favorite is 577 pairs of socks. So over half was a sock. So we again thank you for your service. When we ask, you provide, and that means a great deal to us. Speaking of service, our mission moment, we just want to remind you that our fourth unchurched service will be on Monday night at 7 p.m. at the Phoenix. We're going to do this one, and then we're going to do one in April. And then when the shelter closes, I'm bringing together everybody who's had some input or participated. We may do some tweaking, in particular to move it a little earlier and reach out to those that are at the Phoenix, especially as the men's shelter shuts down for just a couple of months because of the success of One Winter Night. So Unchurch, Monday night at 7 p.m., and those of you who would like input on where we go forward, stay tuned for a meeting that I will hold sometime in March, trying to figure out the best time for that. Lots going on, but of course, we are here to worship, to praise, to think and to live and grow in our faith. So in that sense, I invite you to go to God in prayer as we prepare to give of our offering. O gracious and loving God, we thank you. We indeed thank you for the many opportunities that you offer for us to grow in your grace and love, to look at the life of Jesus and to allow him to teach us how it is we can be more faithful today. So we ask that we begin that right now as we give of our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings. We ask you to bless them, those who have given online, and may all of this be an opportunity for your light and your love to shine into a broken world. We pray these things in Christ's precious name. Amen. Thank you. Let us pray. A loving God, what a powerful reminder of the importance of this season of Lent, an extremely intentional time to focus our eyes and especially, oh God, our hearts on what you have done, are doing, and will do in our lives. And for that, we give you thanks and praise. We know, oh gracious God, that there are far too many times when life gets so busy that we put you down the ladder on the list of things of importance. But this season of Lent is an opportunity to be vulnerable before you, to listen for your voice, to hear what you have to say to us, to examine all the things you would have us learn, so that indeed we can be your children, your faithful disciples and servants. So we thank you for this blessed opportunity. We ask that you help us begin that process this very moment as we pray for those within our lives and our family and our community and beyond who need your special care. We know, oh God, that you are aware of these things and these people, but it helps us to focus again our eyes and our hearts on you. So today we especially lift to you Nancy King and the family of Carrie Martin. Of course, there are many others, O God, and we thank you for being a God who welcomes these needs and these concerns and doesn't turn us away, that you forgive us over and over again. So we humbly come before you. We come with our pain, with our dysfunction, with our hurt, seeking your joy, your peace, and especially your love. We do all these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, on this Communion Sunday, indeed the one who showed us how to live and taught us how to pray this prayer by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was in the wild with the wild animals, and angels attended him. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. The word of God for the people of God.
Hey, good morning. So as we proceed into Lent, I was reminded of an anecdote I heard a while back about a tribe in Africa called the Maasai tribe, fairly well known. They're a nomadic tribe. And so as such, they'll spend a period of time wandering the land. And I'd read an article a while back about how as they do this, they will end up taking an extended period of time, like a whole day, and stopping and resting. And when one of the tribesmen was explaining this practice to an outsider, he said, well, we need to do this so that we can let our souls catch up to us. So I think that's a beautiful and apt metaphor for what Lent might be to us as we order this, we structure the Christian calendar such that it might cause us to interrupt our routine, maybe add or delete some practices that we might have an opportunity to come closer to God. And so I want to start off by Lent by pointing towards the baptism of Jesus and saying that it offers us a window into our own belovedness, that as this text talks about how Christ is the beloved child of God, so we too in it might know something of our own belovedness before God. So this is a familiar passage, I think. It seems like it comes up two or three times a year. one that we hear somewhat often. And if you can just imagine it, you can imagine the crowds had gathered along the little river. They'd run out there to hear John yell at them. He was John the Baptist. He was an eccentric guy, but for some reason or another, his message resonated with the people. It resonated with something deep inside of them. He preached that the One was coming, that God's promises were being fulfilled, that God's presence was coming, that God was on the move and His kingdom was in their midst, and they therefore needed to prepare themselves for this new thing. And so they did. They packed their bags, they put on their swimsuits and their sunscreen, they lined the banks of the little river, and they went in one by one to be dunked, to be renewed. And you can imagine, as they lined the little river, there was a murmur at the back of the crowd, and then a hush. And the crowd kind of started to slowly part, and Jesus walked through them, walking towards the water. Now, at this point in his life, I think people were kind of curiously reverent, right? This is right at the beginning of the book of John. They hadn't seen much of him. They'd only heard a few stories, heard some rumors about who this guy was, what he was saying. And so as he kicked off his flip-flops and strolled into the water, John tried to talk him out of it and say, "You got it all backwards. You should be doing the baptism. You're ordained here, right?" And Jesus finally convinces him. He gets in and he goes under. And perhaps he was officially consecrating his life before God. Perhaps this, again, is the very first thing that happens in the Gospel of Mark. Perhaps he was now dedicating himself, knowing what was to come. The temptation in the wilderness would follow directly after this. And so he comes to do so, making a proclamation before God and before people. And as he comes out, the people are silent and wonder, and so they hear. Maybe they see. I don't know exactly how these things happen in Scripture, but all four Gospels account that something weird did. All four of them, that the people heard the voice of God proclaiming, "You are my beloved Son, and with you I'm well pleased," which is at once a statement of Jesus' divinity, his oneness with God and his mission in the world, but we also proclaim that Jesus is fully human, and that this is also a statement of his belovedness. Has to do with God's love of him as a person. As I read that text, as I think about it from my own life, I wonder how many of us long to hear words like that. How many of us labor through life, maybe continually dunking ourselves in some proverbial river, hoping that it might conjure the approval of God, only leaving to wonder if it worked and where we stand in life. So this Lent, we'll be talking around themes of belovedness in God's sight, which at first might seem a little odd because Lent is often a time of sackcloth and ashes, a time where we acknowledge the ways in which we fall short of the glory of God, a time to acknowledge, to focus on sacrificing something, or at least giving up some chocolate. And it's often a time of introspection, of seeking forgiveness, but we also want to focus on our belovedness before God. And generally speaking, I think we are prone to err in one direction or the other on that topic, to either think that God's love covers us richly, that there's nothing ever wrong in our hearts, that we are beloved and okay, or to think on the other end that we are nothing but dirt, and that God's love is surely not for us, not from the One who sees all that we are. I think that we often try to, we err on one of those poles or the other, and maybe it depends on the day, but the Christian life seeks to hold those things in tension, to acknowledge the ways in which we fall short of loving God and others while simultaneously upholding the strong belief in our belovedness, that God's love is big enough to overcome our shortcomings and not just overcome them, but transform them. So hopefully we can hold those two things together because we need them both, understanding that we all deeply need forgiveness, but that our ability to ask for it is because of God's nature as loving, and from our inherent worth as beloved. And further, we need to remember that the backdrop of Lent is the suffering of Christ, the crucified God who comes and loves. So Jesus comes up out of the water. The people are on the bank. There's towels over their shoulders. They're in their swim trunks still. There's little drips of water running off of them, forming puddles and running back into the little stream. They're quiet as he comes up, flailing a little, and so they hear it. "You are my beloved child with whom I'm well pleased." How many of us, how often do you hope to hear those words? Think on that passage. Think on that verse. How many of us hope and long to hear those words? Well, Jesus was the Messiah, which means that he was sent by God to represent the people. And we see over and over again in the New Testament that what is true for Jesus is true for the people. Paul talks about this a lot. For instance, he talks about, he uses the metaphor of Adam, and he says that as Adam came into the world, as sin came into the world through one man, so all have sinned. And he says, as obedience came into humanity through Christ, so we all have the opportunity through to be obedient. What is true for Christ in the New Testament, not always, but is often true for the rest of humanity. And so it's not a stretch to say that as God proclaims the belovedness of the person of Jesus, God is also speaking through him to the people, to us. And we'll do well to remember here that Jesus hasn't done anything. In our society where doing is often equated with value, Jesus hasn't done anything here. He has simply been the beloved child of God. He hasn't healed. He hasn't. The miracles haven't happened. The sacrificial obedience hasn't. Those things all would come. But he still was the beloved child. Henry Nouwen says that being beloved expresses the core truth of our existence. I'll take a drink of water while that sinks in. Being beloved expresses the core truth of our existence, the very center of human identity. Yet how many of us truly grasp the love of God? I mean, I find it easy to understand, to believe that God loves y'all. I find that easy. I might struggle to love you myself all the time. But I find it easy to believe that God loves you. I find it much simpler to believe that our loving, creating, and redeeming God stands with open arms for you. I find it much harder to believe on a regular basis that the idea that God loves me. With all my faults, with all my past and its woundedness, in spite of all the ways that I've not loved others, that I have turned my heart away from my brother and sister. And I say that because I think that's true for most of us. I think that most of us struggle to really grasp, struggle to understand and own the love of God for our own lives. That most of us don't live out of, operate out of a healthy understanding of God's love for us. And perhaps that's because we're well acquainted with ourselves. We know our depravity. We know who we are when no one is looking. Or maybe it's because of our woundedness or how we've been told over and over again that we don't measure up. Some of us have been told that overtly by people. People who've owned that message for their own lives, who also live into the thought that they are not beloved, that they are not unlovable, and so they don't understand or deeply know their own blessedness, and that shame and fury propels them to project it onto others. But further, we're all told by our culture that love is something to be earned. Earned by the pretty and handsome, earned by the hardworking and able-bodied, that time is money and production is the value of a person. What do you do for a living? And so we hurry and we strive and we work and we hope. We hope that it adds up to meaning. We hope that it adds up to value. We hope that it adds up in the eyes of others and ourselves, that our lives might amount to something, might amount to worth and worthiness. We're constantly told that much of our worth is not inherent. It's interesting, our society simultaneously proclaims, on the one hand, that there are truths that we find to be self-evident, basic equality based on our common humanity, and on the other hand, that to truly live into being worth it, we have to produce and succeed, we have to act and look like the rest. And so we're constantly besieged by our own inner voices, by our own wounded experience, by the subtle messages of our culture, besieged in a way that makes truly living into our belovedness very, very difficult. And for all of those reasons and more, it's hard for us to comprehend God's love, perhaps impossible to truly grasp it. And what makes it harder is that we often conflate our experiences with people with our understanding of God. Many of our broken relationships color how we think about, how we relate to love and forgiveness and worthiness. Many of our broken relationships color how we think about and relate to a being that we often refer to as Father, or one who is even represented by the church. Most of us, maybe all of us, struggle to comprehend the loving nature of God. And that works itself out in our lives in ways that we are often unaware of. Some of us believe that God is mad at us, and so we struggle to make things feel right. Some of us believe that God is indifferent and distant, and so we feel left to ourselves to figure it out. Some of us believe that God is a demanding parent, and so we fear making a wrong move, or we work to gain God's approval, fearing that we'll never measure up. And most of the time, these false theologies are rooted in the wounded narratives of our lives, and we project that onto God and others and ourselves. And so it's easy to say God loves you and me, but there's often a gap between what we say we believe and what we actually believe, and we may not even be aware that that gap actually exists until some event forces it to the surface. Kristen Vincent, in the book that several of our groups are working through this Lent, says that we all have pain in our lives, and our pain has a way of drowning out the sound of our truth. That place deep within us that has always known that we are God's beloved. She goes on to say that this means the spiritual life is, in part, about recovering our voice and returning to our truth. And so I think my grandma knew something. She was a great theologian when she sang, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." It sounds simple, it sounds simplistic, but when you peel back the layers of the onion, you find that there are deep implications into how we live our lives. And our inability, our unwillingness to do the hard work to recover those truths in our lives has significant implications. For it's when we fail to understand our belovedness, and not just understand it, but live it out, that we live instead from fear and insecurity. When we don't understand our belovedness, it's going to be harder to love others well. We're going to have a tendency to hurt others, to compete, and to lie with one another, and to lack trust or be authentic with our true selves. From our own insecurities flow a myriad of relationally destructive behaviors, some of which are incredibly subtle, and much of the time we don't even know they're working on us. And these all have deep implications for our lives together, for community, for marriage, for friendships. And so if Nouwen is right, that belovedness expresses the core truth of our identity, and if our ability to grasp those things, to live out of it, is so often marred, you will see that the uncovering of our woundedness in order to see ourselves as God sees us must be a central aspect of the Christian faith. It's a process that speaks to the core of our identity as children of God, and from this truth, much of our life together and our faith flows. And so this Lent, we want to invite you to contemplate the love of God, and to share that with one another, to contemplate the narratives that you've internalized over the years, to discover where you derive your worth from and return to belovedness. And that's not going to happen quickly. That's not a light switch you flip on. For example, I've had some serious shoulder problems since I was 17 years old or so, since the championship pickleball game in which I dove and dislocated my shoulder. It's a championship game. And some years back, when I was in my early 30s, after another shoulder injury, I was complaining to my doctor, and I said, this thing just isn't, with rehab, just isn't getting better as quickly as I'd hoped. And he just kind of sat back and he said, "Well, how long did it take to get like it is?" Likewise, the state of our souls, the narratives embedded within us, our own views of life and ourselves in them are not going to be transformed quickly. We all want quick fixes, but it'd be good to ask, how long did it take to get like it is? Kristen Vincent says that we are going to need time to wonder, to ponder, to contemplate the scripture, to live in loving community, to be forgiven and forgive, and to own the core truth of our existence. And so I invite you, if you're looking for a practice to add or delete this Lent, consider regularly and intentionally contemplating this core truth of our faith, our belovedness before our Creator, to find scriptures and think on them, to live that out in life together. And in doing that, it'll be good to try to identify and speak to the sources that communicate to us of our own unbelovedness. And I want to say to you that we can't do that without one another. One of the roles of Christian community is to help us see ourselves clearly, to hold up a mirror in front of each other so that we can see ourselves as God truly sees us. And so I invite you to speak a word of encouragement to someone along those lines today. Belovedness expresses the core truth of our identity. And when we grasp that, we will be more secure in the everyday things that come at us. We will be free to love others and celebrate their successes. We'll be more open to encouraging others. We'll be more gentle and understanding and compassionate. We'll feel less need to compete and envy. When we grasp the core truth of who we are, we will work for the honoring of the belovedness of others, especially those whose worth is continually called into question. So after John was done with him, I imagine Jesus gathering himself up, pushing with hands off of the muddy bottom of the river. And then he began kind of stumbling towards the shore, stumbling as you do when you're walking in waist-deep water. People's eyes were trained on him. They were silent at this point. They were enraptured at what has just happened. A little boy whispered to his mother. And as Jesus clambered up the bank, helped up by some dusty onlookers in the root of a tree, imagine him walking through the crowd. They're slowly parting again. But he, this time, stops, puts his hand on the shoulder of people, looks him in the eye, and says, "You too are beloved, my beloved daughter, my beloved son, my beloved child." While those words meant something specific to Jesus, I believe the Spirit wants us to hear them anew today, to know of our infinite worth in the sight of God, to know of our infinite value and of the infinite value of others, and to live into both of those truths. And so I pray that as you go from this place, as you head into Lent, that Lent might be just enough of a seasonal break in things so that you will carve out some space and time to contemplate and to own your belovedness before God. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. And in all things, we pray that you would help us to see. Give us eyes to see, Lord, so that we might understand ourselves and others how you see us. And in that belovedness, may we extend grace and forgiveness and compassion so that others might know you as the God of grace and forgiveness and compassion. In Christ's name, amen. So one of the ways that we know and experience the presence and love of God is through the sacrament of communion. And so I invite you to quiet your hearts, to quiet your spirits, to lift them to the Lord as we proceed into communion.
As you ponder, as you wonder about your belovedness, I hope you'll remember that several years after that baptism, Jesus was gathered in an upper room with his closest friends, some who had failed miserably, who were anything but perfect, but he shared a meal with them. He commissioned them. He loved them. He forgave them. As he took bread, gave thanks to God, broke the bread, and gave it to them so that they would know that he would still be with them on their journey, on their lives, and on their paths. That same night he took a cup, he gave thanks again to God, always thanking God, gave it his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood shed for you, for the forgiveness of sins. And remember me as you drink it." So on this day, I invite God to pour out his Holy Spirit upon each and every one of us, and upon these gifts of bread and juice, so that they indeed can be a profound reminder of God's love for us. Maybe in receiving this meal, you will experience God saying, "You too are my beloved child." And here at Faith and in all United Methodist churches, this is an open table. Nobody is discouraged or prevented from coming. We will give you a piece of bread. You will dip it in the cup. And then, again, we hope you will use this time to begin that Lenten journey, to ask yourself what it is that gets in the way of you hearing God say, "You are loved." So I'd like for those who are to assist to come forward and help us as we prepare to feast at this holy table. Will you come?
Thank you.
I invite you to stand and sing with us as we close our service this morning.
Go from this place, I invite you to join a hand or elbow of your neighbor. I pray that the face of the Lord would be upon you, that the Lord would lift up his countenance towards you, and that as you go from this place, you would know the peace and love and grace of God. Amen.